Howdy, folks. Welcome to Water by the Quarter. This is a show that talks about the most important resource we have, fresh water. I'm Jim Nash, your Oakland County Water Resources Commissioner, and your host. Welcome. Today, we have Ward Detweiler, the host of of Detroit Public Television's Great Lakes Now, and Sandra Svoboda, Program Director and Producer of Great Lakes Now. Well, welcome.
Hey, Jim. Thanks so much for having us back.
I'm glad to have you. This is, first of all, I want to thank Great Lakes Now for the continued support of the Kids Clean Water Calendar Contest. We just are having our award for the top winner for the contest, who won for the second year in a row, which is really first time that's ever happened. That's right. He's a fifth grader now. He's a fourth grader last time. So I really appreciate you judging Ward and Sandy, you doing all the work around getting this out. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. It was fun doing it, was it the second time, third time we've done this now?
Third time.
Seeing the back-to-back winner also teaches his work was phenomenal, really. It really blows me away. So fun to be involved.
He's an amazing young man, and it's truly great. So, I really appreciate that. So, this is our third year together talking. We want to catch up, and we like to kind of catch up with you guys and what you're doing. And this is a terrific show that you do that really focuses again on the most important resource. So I really want to thank you for that. Let me ask you, so, this is an award-winning program. You've won that. What is the focus? What would you tell people is the focus of what you want to have them get from your show?
Well, we really take a regional approach to the Great Lakes, the watershed, and drinking water. And not only our monthly PBS program that airs on Detroit Public Television and all over the region, and on our YouTube channel. But we also have our website where we do daily news and information about the Great Lakes and drinking water issues. We also do a lot of outreach and engagement like this show. We have our own Facebook watch parties twice a month. And then we just launched a new educational initiative as well, where we build middle school content for teachers or at-home learners or anybody else who wants to share information with students about the Great Lakes. So we really have, in the years we've been going now, we've become kind of a multimedia organization. We work with media partners around the region so that we have updated, the best journalistic content around the Great Lakes and drinking water issues that you can find. So we like to have a little bit of fun. We'll talk a little bit more about that in this program, I think. But really, we're a place where you can come to get news about the lakes you love and their watershed.
We're all Michigan here. We're all a part of the watershed. Everything we do goes into the Great Lakes in one way or another. So I really appreciate that. Ward, do you want to say anything?
Yeah, I mean, I guess for me, it's really continuing on a lot of the work that we've done over the past three seasons and really expanding that as well, maybe covering some new stories, adding some new segments and new features. We have a new segment starting in March where we'll be talking with reporters from around the region, both, in the Great Lakes states and Canada, and really try to bring in, other journalistic outlets to represent a variety of stories from, a whole set of diverse communities to really kind of broaden our reach and really just expand the work we've been doing.
That's wonderful. So what can we expect to see this season? What are the things you'll be covering? What do you think the most important ones are?
Oh, gosh, you can't ask us what the most important ones are, Jim. That's too hard a question. That's a question journalists ask, Jim. We can't answer that.
Like your favorite child, right?
Right. Well, I mean, I think, we know that our audience is very interested in the cycles of water levels, issues of climate change, invasive species in the lake system as well. We also do a lot on drinking water. We actually publish every 2 weeks, we publish a roundup of drinking water headlines from around the region. We don't have the capacity to cover every single one of those stories ourselves, but we make sure that we do headline roundups around both the issue of PFAS and drinking water in the Great Lakes. As to what you're going to see more of, I'll speak to the serious side, and then I will let Ward tell you what he thinks he's going to be doing this summer, which is a lot more fun than we're going to let him have, I think. But we're doing more work with our partners at the Great Lakes News Collaborative. That's Bridge Michigan, Circle of Blue, and Michigan Radio. There's a big project coming out in May, and I think what I can say about it safely is that it's all about the cost of water. whether that's your at-home bill for drinking water or what the country and the region beyond needs for the infrastructure that we need to have clean and safe water. So we'll be looking at that. And then we also just relaunched our education initiative. I can talk more about that in a minute, but we're actually tying learning materials to our monthly show. So every month there's a new set of learning activities and lesson plans, and they're tied to standards for the teachers watching. Every month that's going to come out of a segment that is in our show. So we're doing a lot more this year, sort of timely around our content, because we know that our audience is hungry for the additional educational materials everyone's come to expect from PBS. But I'll let Ward talk a little bit more about some of the interesting subjects around the lakes that are on our to-do list.
God, is this my wish list, or is this?
Well, you know, tread lightly here, Ward. It's not the assignment. Yeah, I'm not. List. I said we could do
demands, but you know, one of the things that I really like about the show is that we really have a great mix of what I think are very, you know, serious science-driven topics about some of the larger issues facing the lakes, but you know, also have focus on a lot of more fun things and recreational issues. And my personal, you know, ethos about this whole thing is that I think the best way for people to care about the lakes and to care about the world and environment around them is to find ways to enjoy it. And I think there's so many different ways that people appreciate the lakes, interact with the lakes, experience everything that we have here that around us that makes this region so unique, that I personally love highlighting those sorts of stories, especially because there's so many weird and interesting ways that people get into it.
Yeah,
he just wants to go fishing more on camera. That's why he's saying
that. Me. I love
it. I'm fishing. Still waiting, yeah.
No, that's terrific. And it's true. People have such an attachment to the Great Lakes, especially in Michigan, that it's even subconscious. I really think it is. People just react to it. And it's just, they understand the quality of the water and that we have to protect it. So again, going back to our contest winner, he's several times expressed to me the need for him to really work to make sure that the Great Lakes are taken care of. And he's only 10 years old. So, I mean, that's the kind of thing people are attached to this, to the Great Lakes here. I really believe that. So, you know, you've had 3 years. How do you think this has grown? I see you have great plans for the future. You've grown quite a bit. Well, how do you see that? You started out with a more simple mission, I think.
Well, you know, paying attention to the Great Lakes goes back way before my 3.5 years at Detroit Public Television. Years ago, there was a documentary about the Great Lakes, and the audience response was so overwhelming that people at the station, I mean, they knew the lakes were important, but when they really saw the questions people had and how people really tied in with that content, there were more efforts done. They started with conferences, bringing those more academic sides of things to bigger audiences through streaming, traveling around the region, getting a video medium for the scientists that sometimes did not have it, and being aligned with some of those partners in those policy and academic research groups. That sort of went into the website that we have with news stories about the lakes. There were quarterly documentaries done back in 2017, 2018, and then late 2018, beginning of 2019 was when we really launched this monthly show. And we've been able to build out all those content platforms around it. You know, sometimes we publish a news story first, and then a few months later, you'll see kind of a version of it in the show. You'll see our writer on camera talking about his or her stories that were on the website and the elements of those and the issues. Or sometimes you'll see stories co-published along with the show on the website. And, you know, everybody's, as we say, consuming content, but everybody reads on different platforms. You may watch a show, you may watch on PBS, or you may watch on YouTube. So what we've really tried to do is take a story and present it on all of those different platforms in different ways that give people the information they want, that they need, or they didn't know that they wanted to have sometimes.
I gotcha. Ward, anything you want to add to that, or?
Yeah, I guess in terms of how the show is changing, or at least how we hope things are changing, you know, the pandemic was tough in terms of us getting out in the field, but now that is sort of lifting, it's fun to go from being just, you know, sort of the host of the show to actually getting to be out and participate in the field and create our own stories. We've got to do some really fantastic and fun and very interesting and unique stories. The archaeology, underwater archaeology school story we did last summer was actually one of my personal favorites. That was just because I'm a total nerd. So that was really fun. And then next month, you'll get to see me go ice boating for the first time, which was the most fun I think I've ever had in my life. So I'm excited to see us get more active and be able to produce more of our own content and get involved more.
So you've been out in the public a lot. You talk to just regular folks. You talk to scientists. You talk to a lot of people affected. How does the public respond to you now? They've known you. They've seen articles. They've seen pieces by you. You're getting a lot of good good communications with people out in the world.
Yeah,
I'll let Ward answer that. Yeah,
that's been kind of fun for me. I mean, what's one thing that's meaningful is like friends and family and work colleagues who come up and say how they watch the show, and like that's great. But when you get somebody's randomly. Two really random ones we had. I remember driving back from Alpena with Sandy, and we stopped in Agres to go get a bite to eat in this little log cabin bar. And there's this group of guys in the corner just sort of staring over us. And we're like, what are you guys looking at? Just, sort of boozing at 2 p.m. perhaps, sort of those types. And then one guy starts walking over oh no, what does he want? It's like, aren't you on that PBS show? I was like, oh, look at that. So it was fun seeing the reach of our fans, but even further, I was in the Mexico City airport, the Aeromexico lounge, talking to some people who were there and where they're from. And they're like, wait a second, we watch Great Lakes Now. You're on that show. And so it was so crazy being, thousands of miles away and seeing the reach that seeing recognition. So it's really surprising to see where the viewership comes from and also what strikes people and what people are interested in. I think this is nice because it helps guide us, but also, it's nice recognition.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it really is. And well, when you're out there telling their stories, that's people react to that. They have a visceral reaction to that this is something I care about. So you're associated with that. And that's something that you'll be with a long time, I hope. So I that's just the kind of thing you can do when you're on TV, explaining things in a way that people understand. It stays with them. So I think that's really cool. So you mentioned the stories you like to cover. Do you see this as something that it's going to be kind of things develop as you're going? It's not something that you have an idea of. It comes to you as something that's something that you think you should be investigating. Is that how kind of things develop?
We kind of do a balance. You're asking what goes in the show? How do we pick our segments? Yeah. We have a mission. We definitely have a mission. And that is news and information about the Great Lakes and the watershed and drinking water. Now, that ranges from the restoration efforts around the Spectacle Reef Lighthouse that was in our January show, the beginning of the new season. That means Ward in an ice boat, as he described. That means some more serious issues about the military's response to PFAS contamination, specifically in the Oscoda community, but that story could be told around the region. And so, we really try to do a mix within our show, or at least if you look at a group of shows, of topics, of approaches. Some are more serious, more news documentary style. Some are a little lighter and more based on some are more based on interviews. We really try to have diversity through the kinds of communities we're in, the region. I put points on a map and track where we've been. We have not gotten really the North Shore, the far North Shore of Lake Superior yet, but we're gonna get there hopefully this summer. And so we really try to make sure that we're representing both sides of the border. We're a binational operation, as the Great Lakes are. And so really sometimes it just kind of comes down to what producer is available to do that segment. So it's really a mix, Jim, of what gets in the show. But I think, I hate looking at one show because I think, we could have done this, we could have done that. But if you really look at our work as a whole, you find that we present a variety of sides of issues. We talk to those people. We have, quote, regular people, whether those are business owners or volunteers in a community science project or citizens enjoying the lakefront. We have those voices along with some of the top scientists in the region, some politicians, experts, and advocates as well.
Sure. I want to go back a minute. You mentioned what you were going to be reporting on affordability, on the costs of water and things like that. Do you want to expand on that a little bit? My office is working with Pontiac and Royal Oak Township on an affordability program to develop for those two communities. The state has given us a grant so they can, we're going to do a report so they can kind of scale this for any community in the state. So we're very interested in this. We've been working for over a year now with a stakeholder group in the communities and you know, all our government folks from city council to U.S. senators. So what are you guys looking at? How are you approaching that?
Well, several ways. Number one, with our partners. So as I mentioned, Circle of Blue at circleblue.org, Bridge Michigan, and Michigan Radio all have really top-notch environmental journalists, as well as our contributing writers and our news director from Great Lakes Now. They'll all be producing in-depth stories around various aspects of affordability, of infrastructure, of policy and planning. See where we're going there. Community involvement, you know, we want, I think people can come into this series because we all get a water bill, right? We all pay for water in one way or another. And so starting with that as a touch point, you know, sometimes it's hard to get audiences relate to something on the North Shore of Lake Superior when they're on the Eastern Shore of Lake Ontario, for example. But we really are all connected through water throughout this region. So we'll start with that and then look more at the infrastructure issues and other cost issues going forward. We do not have, I mean, we're taping this in February, I guess. The project's coming out in May. The stories are being reported. There will be a full Great Lakes Now program as our May show. And then within Detroit Public Television, there will also be shows and segments and even our PBS Books Initiative and our radio station WRCJ as a jazz and classical station. They'll be doing playlists of music inspired by water. So they'll really be, you know, pardon the analogy, the full court press at Detroit Public Television, getting out all of these opportunities to explore the issue of cost of water, to bring a bigger understanding to the community. And we'll certainly have engagement events around that. We'll have our usual watch party the Tuesday before our show airs. And we're planning a couple of PBS Books events as well to address the topic. So stay tuned, as we say in the business, Jim, if you'll forgive that one. But we have a lot more coming in May, and we'll be happy to share all that. If people really want the advanced preview, you can subscribe to our newsletter on our website.
I think that's terrific. This is something that people really need to understand. And it's not just cities, big water systems, septic systems, well systems. There's all kinds of issues around the state that are going to affect people. So that's really important that we talk about those things. I really appreciate that. That's the kind of thing that you can do that really, I think, helps people understand this. It means a lot.
I will pass that along to the journalists. I know all of those words you mentioned, I've seen in documents planning this project.
Well, that's terrific. That's terrific. So I know you've talked about PFAS. You've covered it in some, do you see yourselves, can you briefly what you've covered in the past and if you're looking at things in the future? And also around lead, are those things that you're looking at?
Yes. We had a few segments in the last year about lead, getting the lead out. That has been some stories from our partners and the Great Lakes News Co-op Collaborative as well. We've co-published their stories. PFAS continues to be an issue. I mentioned the Air Force story last year. You know, my first real project was the Forever Chemicals documentary that debuted in March of 2018. And I'm surprised how relevant that still is. We've done screenings as recently as a few months ago of that documentary. That is still on our website at greatlakesnow.org/foreverchemicals. That story was, that documentary really looked at the human cost of PFAS in West Michigan communities. So as other states are sort of reaching, I mean, believe it or not, Michigan was a little bit ahead in the testing and detection. Where we go from there is, or where other states are going is sort of towards Michigan. And so we'll be looking at some of those other states, both in our web content and in the show. And then as far as the lead issue, we had a segment in our November show in Benton Harbor. We went along with MLive reporter Garrett Ellison, who was also in the Forever Chemicals. So you can guess what his beat is as a journalist: water in Michigan, environmental issues. We had not planned to go to Benton Harbor. We had other segments lined up for November, but that was such a big story and so important for people to understand. It was a different dimension of the lead issue, but still the lead issue, a different dimension than Flint, I should say. And so we quickly substituted a segment, sent crews out, and brought that story about what that community is experiencing. So both of those topics are on our radar, Jim. We put them in our headline news roundups every 2 weeks. And so we continue to look around the region to tell that story, which unfortunately is sometimes the same as what we've seen.
Right. Right. The thing was, our biggest concern around the lead and copper rule was the cost to the communities of replacing all those lines would have hit some of our poorer communities really hard. This outside money, this federal money, is going to make it possible to do it way faster than we could have done it and not hit the ratepayers. So that's super important for my office. The PFAS, my office really hasn't been that involved with it. We did testing on all the well systems we use, and we didn't find any in our systems. So that's good. We're tracking some of the places that it's spreading from sites that were known in the past. So we're tracking that to see if, you know, when it starts approaching places where there's wells, we'll have to shut down wells and do things like that. So there's a lot of the things that this impacts people in ways that they, until they've seen it to themselves, people have no idea. And so it can have a huge effect on people, especially in rural areas where they're using wells. So this is something that. Again, educating the public on that is just so important to me. So I really appreciate what you do on that.
Nice to hear. Thank you, Jim.
Absolutely. Anything else you want to cover that we haven't really talked about? I there were a couple of things that I think we've already talked about that you mentioned, but is anything else that you'd like to talk about?
Ward?
Not necessarily in particular, but I think maybe kind of bring it all together. We cover a lot of issues, as Sandy mentioned, you know, like an issue that might be in the North Shore of Lake Superior may not seem relevant to somebody, in Lake Ontario, but it's all the same system. And I think that even some of these events, like looking at something like PFAS or lead, it may not be the exact same thing, but it's the same sort of system that's happened, the same things that are going on. It can still be relevant to your community. So I think the main thing is that, one, I'd love to expand our reach to other, a broader segment of the Great Lakes region. Cover more stories, but it's, I think all of these things that we cover, no matter where you're located, no matter where you're watching, we are relevant to you and to where you live and to the system. It's all one interconnected system, and we all sort of need to care about it and protect it together. So I just hope we continue to have as much success as we have, and thank you for having us on and continuing to support us and spread the word. So I just really appreciate that.
Well, this is the kind of thing that public TV is. I mean, that's just why we have it. That's why people watch things, is because you guys cover it in a way that people understand, that's thorough, and that is just on target. And it's so important. People want to care. People want to have a reason to care and understand the things that are facing our water resources. And I, when I go out in the public and I talk to groups, I do a lot of talks in libraries and things, and people have so many questions. And again, human nature, if people don't understand it, they fill in the blanks themselves, and it's usually much darker than really is. So the more you can explain, the more people will understand and agree that we need to do the right thing for these resources. So again, that's something that you're doing a great job, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you. I have a bit of a cold here.
Coughing fit.
Badly timed coughing fit, but I appreciate that, Jim.
Oh, no problem. No problem. We got to see Smokey the Bear there, so we're good.
Glad that picture made an appearance.
Well, I really appreciate it, folks. I hope to see you again next year, and we'll have a lot more stuff to talk about. So thank you so much for coming. And again, this has been a great, great interview. I always learn something from you guys.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much. And hopefully we can see you again soon.
Sounds wonderful. Thank you, folks. You take care now.
WRC, in collaboration with CMNtv, are proud to announce that our public affairs program, Water by the Quarter, has won the prestigious Communicators Award. We received the Silver Award and is recognized with the Award of Distinction in the Social Issues and Responsibility category in the Film, Television, and Video class.